Hello, good evening everybody. Welcome, let's crack NEET PG. So let me introduce myself. I'm Dr. Deepika Gupta. I did my MBBS and MD in Obstetrics and Gynecology from AIIMS New Delhi. And I did my MCH in Surgical Oncology from Kidwai Cancer Institute, Bangalore. So yes, I've been through the grind of multiple medical entrance exams. I understand what your problem areas where you need some help. And I hope that I can use my personal academic experience to help you crack your next exam. The first thing you need to do, you need to download the Unacademy Learning app, right? This is freely available on the Google and the Apple Store. Once you get the app, you get access to the country's top educators. They are doing very well professionally, academically, and most important of all, they have put in a lot of time and effort so that you may also excel in your upcoming examination. Okay, so we have two subscriptions available. The first is the plus subscription, which is like a live classroom, just like today, where you have an educator who will discuss a particular topic with you. You can ask your doubts there and then. You can solve MCQs, have quizzes. Then you have the iconic subscription, which gives you access to the live classroom of Unacademy, as well as a lot of the prep ladder content. So in the prep ladder, you will get a lot of videos on all important topics of your 19 subjects, question banks and handwritten notes. So once you choose which if you choose for the iconic subscription, you need to decide the duration depending where you are in your MBBS curriculum, okay, and which year exam you want to target. Then you use my code Dr. Deepika, and on using my code Dr. Deepika, you will get a discount of 10%, which will bring down your cost by 5,000. Similarly, if you choose the plus subscription, now my advice to you, please take a longer duration depending upon where you are in the MBBS curriculum. You are a third year, you are a fourth year, you are an intern, okay, which exam you want to target, and then use my code Dr. Deepika and you will get a 10% discount. Your monthly EMI will become so less, you can easily pay it out of your own stipend. We have a lot of batches going on for you. We have a batch for the upcoming exam in April. Then we have a batch for the INICET exam. And we have batches going on for the next year exam. So please choose according to your preparation. For those who are targeting this exam, we have a lot of test series going on for you. We have T20 test series where you can do quick questions and brush up your knowledge. Then we have a grand test series where you can see your national ranking. We have a scholarship test series, the prize winner of which will get a free subscription for Unacademy. Okay, so now let me come to the topic at hand. We have been discussing about cervicitis, vaginitis, and we discussed about gonorrhea, chlamydia, then we discussed about pelvic inflammatory disease. The discussion is not complete without discussion on genital tuberculosis, because in our country, TB is a very, very important cause of recurrent PID, right? And TB is a very important cause leading to your upper genital tract damage, infertility and all. So now let us discuss about TB today. So again, we will be discussing under the following headings, right? We will be talking about the pathogenesis, the clinical features, how do we diagnose and how do we manage. So if the audio video is clear, please give me a thumbs up, then we can go ahead with the discussion for today. So yeah, now you have read this topic thoroughly in medicine, I'm sure. We will just go over the basics of mycobacteria. So mycobacteria complex is responsible for your tuberculosis. Okay, the most common site affected is the lungs. But yes, genitourinary tuberculosis is also a problem, particularly in our country. And the most common causative organism is your Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Okay. Other than that, the Mycobacterium bovis is also implicated in certain patients. But in your immunocompetent patients, these are the only two which will be generally seen. But in immunocompromised patients, you will start seeing other varieties. Okay, you will start seeing other bacilli, your Mycobacterium africanum, micro T, atypical mycobacteria. All these are generally not seen in your immunocompetent patients. Okay, so what is the mode of spread? How does one get genital tuberculosis? See, for lungs, we know if you are in contact with an active TB case, that person is coughing, you come in contact with the sputum, you get infected. But how is it reaching the genital structures? So it is reaching by the blood. Okay, the most common route of spread is your hematogenous or blood borne spread. So somebody who is having your pulmonary tuberculosis, from the lungs, it will go and spread into the genital structures also. Then your second route of spread is lymphatic spread. Okay. Then third is direct. So what is direct? There is an abdominal TB. Okay. There is complete peritoneal involvement, intestine involvement is there. And from there, if your disease is spreading and involving the tubes and the uterus, then that is called as direct involvement. So direct is basically from the abdominal. So person is having abdominal tuberculosis. Okay. Right. Then what is this ascending? So ascending is basically primary tuberculosis. Primary tuberculosis, that is the partner is infected. Okay, the partner of the woman is carrying your tuberculosis, is carrying genital tuberculosis. So from that the lady might get infected. So that is basically ascending infection or sexually acquired infection. But this primary tuberculosis is very rare. Okay, if tuberculosis is going to be acquired through the partner, then where is it going to spread? It is going to generally, lesion will be seen where? In the vulva, in the vagina, or in the cervix. Okay, but again, this primary tuberculosis is very rare. The common one is your secondary tuberculosis or secondary infection, which most common route is the bloodborne mets. After that is your lymphatic, it can be mesenteric nodes, mostly through the mesenteric nodes. Then third is your direct route. Okay, then what is the most common site from where infection is spreading? So infection will spread from lungs. Okay, most important, this is very very important, most common site of spread is lungs. After that is lymph node. Then after that you have your kidney, GIT and others. Okay, so this has been asked as an MCQ, this has been asked as an MCQ. Okay, hi Shomela. So now what is happening? See, many times what happens is a person has gotten pulmonary tuberculosis and there was bloodborne spread. At that time that your tubercle bacilli has gone and lodged in the genitourinary system. And many times when the person is immunocompromised or at the time of puberty, when your reproductive system is getting activated, at that time these dormant bacilli may become again active or may reactivate. So that is why they may show reactivation at the time of puberty. Okay. So, now, where is it going to spread? The most common site. Now, this is also one-liner MCQ. The most common site of spread is fallopian tube. 95% of cases of genitourinary TB. So, if somebody has genitourinary TB, there is a 90 to 95% chance that the fallopian tubes are definitely going to be involved. Okay. Both, and generally it is bilateral involvement. Okay, there is going to be bilateral involvement in 95% of the cases, and the most common site that is involved is affected is your ampulla. Generally the entire tube will be affected, but if they ask you to pick one particular site, then ampulla is the site that is most commonly involved. Okay, after that second is endometrium. Second is your endometrium, 50 to 60%. Now these numbers are important to remember. Okay, so fallopian tube is 90 to 95. Okay, endometrium is 50 to 60. So okay, then third is your ovaries, 20 to 30. Cervix, vagina and vulva are rare. Okay, cervix, vagina and vulva are rare. So again, the how is the disease coming? Disease is coming through the blood, most commonly from the primary site is the lung. It is first going to involve your fallopian tubes. From the fallopian tubes, it can go and involve the endometrium, it can go and involve the ovaries. Okay, then again further descent of the infection can happen in the cervix, vagina or vulva also, but this is rare. And if primary tuberculosis is happening, okay, that is your acquired through the sexual partner, then that is generally going to involve these sites, cervix, vagina and vulva. Clear? Okay, so now let us look at the fallopian tube. See, one is you understand your fallopian tubes, how important they are for conception, right? Because your fimbria are there or are lying on the ovary, they have to pick up the ova that has to ovulate. Okay, then your ova will go and lodge in the ampulla, sperm will also reach there, fertilization is going to happen. From the fertilization, this your zygote is supposed to stay there for 4 days and then it is supposed to reach the uterine cavity for implantation. So the fallopian tube has a lot of function. This function is structural also and mechanical also. One is that it has to, the lumen has to be open, the environment has to be good so that fertilization can happen. Okay, second is the ciliary function is also very important, because the cilia help in the motion of the zygote towards the uterine cavity. If this motion will not be there, then what will happen? If the person, lady, can land up with an ectopic pregnancy. Okay, so that is why this fallopian tube involvement is a very very important thing for us. So there can be two ways. Endocell pancreatitis means what? Mucosa involvement is there. Okay, mucosa involvement is there. So ciliary damage is going to be there, right? Then what will happen? Your mucosa will become thickened. There will be fibrosis. Okay, it will lose its motility. And that is why we call it like a lead pipe. Okay, it becomes like a lead pipe. It is hard, it is fibrosed, and that motion of the tube is also lost. So finally, what will happen? Fibrosis is going to happen. Then second is exocell pancreatitis. What is exocell pancreatitis? At outside part of the tube is getting affected. So what will happen? You will see that a lot of granulomas are appearing on the surface. Okay, lot of granulomas are appearing on the surface, and there will be formation of peritubal adhesions. Okay, peritubal adhesions will form. There may be formation of a TO mass. So that is exocell pancreatitis. Okay. So let us come to the endometrium now. So endometrium, we remember that 50 to 60% times endometrium is going to be involved. Now what will happen? The tubercle bacilli will go and they will lodge in the basal layer. Okay, they will go and sit in the basal layer. What will they do? They will lead to, again, first there is going to be a lot of inflammation. Okay, once the tubercle bacilli has reached, a lot of your white cells will start coming in, a lot of mononuclear cells will come, inflammation is going to be there. Okay, and then later what will happen? Later again fibrosis is going to happen. Okay, so once at the time when this inflammation is happening, what is going to happen? Bleeding will increase. Okay, bleeding will increase. So there will be some menorrhagia at this time, but again the person is going to land up with fibrosis, and what is going to happen? That is going to be hypomenorrhea or amenorrhea. Okay, so when you look at the endometrium, it will be pale, there will be a lot of intrauterine adhesions, and your cavity size will become smaller. Okay, every time menses will happen, but again the endometrium will get reinfected. How? Either it can be that the infection is coming down from the fallopian tube, or it can be that this basal layer of the endometrium is harboring the bacilli, and that is why it is getting reinfected again and again. Hi Uttam, I am very happy to see you, but I have been taking regular classes, maybe you were busy. Okay, so even I thought, where are you? I have not seen you in many classes. So now what about the ovary? So ovary, we remember that 20 to 30% times ovary is involved. Okay, so 20 to 30%, Shumela, I'll ask and tell you this. I am not sure how you can join. Okay, I will ask and tell you. So ovary, 20 to 30% involvement can be there. So now again, in the ovary also there can be external involvement, there can be involvement from the center. So periopheritis, this is more common. Okay, this is more common, that surrounding the ovary, there will be lot of inflammation, there will be granulomas present on the surface of the ovary. Okay, granulomas will be present on surface, and there will be formation of a TO mass. Okay, there will be formation of a TO mass, there will be lot of adhesions. Okay, the complete tubo ovarian anatomy will be destroyed. Then second is what? Oophoritis. Oophoritis is what? The ovarian stroma itself has gotten infected. So here inside the ovary, a lot of caseating granulomas will develop. Okay, this is less common as compared to your periopheritis, because you have this thick tunica albuginea, right? So this tunica albuginea generally will prevent the invasion by the tubercle bacilli inside. So generally the infection is confined to the external surface, but yes, in some cases through bloodborne metastasis, through bloodborne spread, oophoritis can happen. Okay, then comes your cervical involvement. So cervical involvement is much lesser, we read. Okay, so cervix, I only seen one or two cases where cervix is only involved by tuberculosis. Cervix might appear normal, or there can be a very hard ulceroproliferative growth which mimics a CA cervix. Only when you do a biopsy will you come to know. Okay, you will see your caseation, you will see epithelioid granulomas, and then you will see your giant cells. Okay, then you will get to know that this is tuberculosis, what you were thinking as malignancy. So this infection can again be descending infection, which is more common, or it can be sexually transmitted, that is primary infection. Okay, so next comes your vagina and vulva. Very rare. It can present as a hypertrophic lesion, it can present as a non-healing ulcer, it can present with as a sinus. So sinus is a very important presentation of tuberculosis. Okay, sinus and non-healing ulcer. Again, biopsy is only going to tell you that this is tuberculosis, and if you give ATT, your ulcer and sinus is going to heal. Okay. Then comes your pelvis and peritoneum. So now the infection was in the tubes, right? If infection was in the tubes, it was in the endometrial cavity. So very rarely it will go down in the cervix, but from the tubes it can go outside into involve the peritoneal wall. Okay, it can go and involve the pelvic and the peritoneal wall. So one presentation can be where there is a lot of ascites, okay, and there is peritoneal inflammation, that is called as the serous type. This name you do not need to remember, just that one is there can be ascites and peritoneal inflammation, patient will present with the fever and peritonitis like features, and second will be the where there are small tender abdominal masses and the abdomen is doughy. Okay, so there can be pelvis and peritoneal involvement. Then comes the clinical features. So this is a chronic disease. There are not very specific symptoms are not present. Okay, patient might come to you with infertility, patient might come to you with menstrual complaints, and what they are having is tuberculosis. So you being in India have to think that this patient actually might be having tuberculosis, and even 10-15% patients may be asymptomatic. So that is also important to know. Okay, everybody will not present with symptoms. So what are the most common symptoms? So if we look at the most common symptom in our country, infertility is the most common symptom. Okay, then second is your menstrual irregularity. We discussed initial phase when there is a lot of endometritis, inflammation is happening, a lot of inflammatory cells are there. Then in that stage, early stage, there is going to be menorrhagia. Okay, there is going to be menorrhagia. Later on, as your endometrium is getting damaged, it is becoming pale and thin, then what is going to happen? Adhesions are forming, then the patient will land up with oligomenorrhea and hypomenorrhea, scanty menses, and finally the patient will have amenorrhea. Okay, so tuberculosis is a very important cause of secondary amenorrhea. Okay, secondary amenorrhea, right? Then comes your, now let us discuss this infertility in detail. Okay, this is a very important point about tuberculosis in our country. It can lead to primary infertility, it can lead to secondary, but again primary infertility with tuberculosis is more common. Okay, so now let us remember the incidence. In our country, what is seen is that among all TB patients, 70% will be infertile. Okay. And in our country, 14-17% of infertility is caused by tuberculosis. Okay, is caused by tuberculosis. Fine. So these two numbers you can remember. TB will lead, TB patients among all 100 patients of TB, 70 of genitourinary TB, 70% will be infertile. Okay, and in overall causes of infertility, 14-17% are actually having tuberculosis. So you can understand the load. You are seeing so much infertility increasing in our OPDs these days. So why is it tuberculosis is a very important cause, and it is a treatable cause, right? So we should be familiar with the, and we should always think of this as one differential. So now why is infertility having? First and most important is your tubal factor. We read that 90-95% times your tubes are getting damaged. Okay, so tubes are getting damaged, tubal function is damaged, the ciliary motion is lost, the motility of the tubes is lost, then the tubes can be blocked, the fimbria can be agglutinated, and there can be formation of a retort shaped tube. Okay, because fimbrial agglutination has happened, some fluid collection will happen here, and there will be formation of a hydrosalpinx. Okay, there will be formation of a hydrosalpinx, right? This is also called as a retort shaped tube. Fine. Another presentation will be what? There is a tube, but there are so many multiple levels of constriction are present. Okay, and the fimbria are also agglutinated. So this is called as a beaded tube. There is loss of motility of the tube, and there is blockage of the tube. So these are the problems which are leading to tube infertility. Okay, then there are other factors also. You have your uterine factor. Why? Because endometrium has gotten damaged, endometrium has become pale, atrophic, it is damaged, it cannot receive the embryo for implantation. So what is the problem is what? That there is defect in implantation also. So by any chance, if the zygote has reached the blastocyst is coming and wants to implant in the endometrium also, the endometrium is not ready to receive. Okay, because the cavity is small, there are a lot of adhesions, and vascularity of this endometrium is not good. Okay, vascularity is poor. And there is an inflammatory environment. All these factors will inhibit implantation. Okay, then you have an ovarian factor. What is this ovarian factor? See, any chronic infection will lead to what? Will affect, decrease the gonadotropin synthesis, right? Decrease the gonadotropin synthesis, and this will cause what? This is going to again cause anovulation. But now if we look at all the factors, then we know the tubal factor and the uterine factor are the most important causes of infertility. Okay, yes, anovulation is also happening, but again, this is your most important cause of infertility. Clear? So now let us look at other features. The patient can present with abdominal pain. Okay, so sometimes the patient can present with chronic pain. Sometimes there may be an exacerbation. There may be acute pain. There can be dyspareunia. Okay. Suppose if you do an HSG if you do a procedure and the patient is having active tuberculosis, if you do a DNC, then this pain may again flare up. Okay. Then there can be vaginal discharge. Patient will present with pelvic inflammatory disease. Okay, so recurrent PID like symptoms will be there. Recurrent PID like symptoms are going to be there, and this PID does not get cured with your routine antibiotics. Okay, does not, you are giving doxycycline, metrogyl, but patient is not getting cured with your routine antibiotics, then you must think that this could be tuberculosis. Okay, then if suppose a young girl, okay, young prepubertal girl or young girl who is not sexually active, if she is having a pelvic inflammatory mass, then you must definitely think of tuberculosis. Okay, in a sexually active adult lady, yes, you can think about gonorrhea, chlamydia, all this. But if a young girl is having a pelvic inflammatory mass, then you must definitely think about tuberculosis. If the lady is having a PID which is not responding to your routine doxycycline, metrogyl, ceftriaxone, then you must think that or she is having repeated episodes, then you should think about tuberculosis also. Okay, then I told you that tuberculosis can lead to ectopic pregnancy also. Sometimes there can be formation of fistula also. Okay, if it is completely left untreated, then there can be fistula development. Okay, so this were the genitourinary features. Then definitely you will have your systemic features. Patient can have fever with night sweats, anorexia, weight loss, poor general condition. That is the medicine part of it. Okay. So now let us look at the clinical features. So again, systemic features you will look at, patient might have fever, patient might be pale, then there can be lymphadenopathy. Then if you will do a chest examination, you can hear some crepitations, right? So all this is very, very important. Then you will go for your per abdomen examination. Now in this per abdomen examination, sometimes you might find ascites. Okay, then the abdomen may be generalized, some tenderness may be there. Okay, there may be some generalized tenderness. Then typically one word is used to describe this abdomen, that is called as doughy abdomen. Okay, that is doughy abdomen. Sometimes you may feel some vague masses. Okay, this could be that there is some momentum you are able to palpate, or sometimes there may be some encysted ascites. So all these things can be palpated. Then comes your pervaginal examination. Pervaginal examination, what is going to happen? In a majority of patients, the PV examination is normal. Why? Because this is most of the involvement is of the lining of the endometrium, lining of the fallopian tube. So that is why pervaginal examination may be normal in many cases. But yes, there can be in some patients there might be some uterine tenderness. Okay, if the patient is having a huge hydrosalpinx, then there can be adnexal tenderness. You might even be able to palpate this hydrosalpinx. Okay, so these features can be present, but the most common finding is that it is normal. Okay, fine. Then we go to when should you suspect. So if you are seeing a premenopausal lady, she is presenting with infertility, she is presenting with menstrual problems or any unexplained abdominal pain or pelvic mass, you should think about tuberculosis. And if systemic symptoms are there, then it will help you further corroborate your diagnosis. Fine. now let us go to diagnosis. So we read about the history, physical examination. One more point in history I forgot to tell you is history of ATT of the lady, or if any TB contact is there in the family. Okay, if somebody has a close contact with tuberculosis patient, right? Then comes your investigations. So you will do a complete blood count with ESR. Why? What will you see? You might see anemia, you might see lymphocytosis. Okay, right? ESR will be raised because this is an inflammatory condition. Then you will do a chest x-ray because you want to rule out pulmonary TB, right? Then you want to do a Montu test, right? So Montu's test, again, the interpretation is not so easy. Why? Because if it is positive, it could be a past infection or it could be a current infection, right? So in our country, most patients will test Montu positive. Then you will like to do an ultrasound because you want to see if there is some TO mass, if there is some any hydrosalpinx. Particularly if your examination is suggestive of an adnexal mass, you want to do a pelvic ultrasound. Okay. Then comes your other investigations. You have endometrial biopsy, curettage, aspirate. So some way you can get the endometrium sample. When will you want to do? Typically when the patient is presenting either with infertility or the patient is presenting with hypomenorrhea or amenorrhea. So if a patient is presenting with these two complaints, what do you want to do? You want to do an endometrial biopsy and see whether the tuberculosis has infected, right? Then you have your menstrual blood for culture. If you see, menstrual blood for culture was used initially, but the growth of the mycobacterium is very poor and staining is not so easy in this. So it is not a very good method. Then you have your PCR method. PCR method is very, very sensitive. Okay, so now with COVID-19, we have been hearing so much about PCR. So yes, PCR is very, very sensitive. It can detect even a small amount of organisms, right? But the problem with PCR is it cannot differentiate between dead versus live bacilli. So it cannot tell whether there is an active infection right now. Then this newer modality, GeneXpert, you must have heard, this is mainly used for MDR-TB, okay? Multi-drug resistance tuberculosis. Then you have certain imaging, HSG, endoscopy. This we are going to discuss in detail. So endometrial TB, you will obtain a endometrial aspirate, particularly in the premenstrual phase. Okay, you will see caseation, you will see granulomas, you can see some epithelial destruction. Okay, so all this you are going to see. So this sample of histopathology is sent in formalin. Okay. This you should be knowing. Actually, this is a very practical thing. When we take the endometrial biopsy for histopathological examination, we will send it in formalin. But if you want to do a AFB and a PCR, we will send it in saline, normal saline. Fine. So we will do an AFB staining. So you have the Zeal Neisel staining, right? And you will look for your AFB bacilli. Then culture is not a very good test to do. Why? Because it takes a long time, right? You have your LJ media, but it will take 6 to 8 weeks. Then you have some early culture methods called as BACTEC, right? But again, this will take 5 to 7 days. So generally, we prefer either histopathology, AFB staining or PCR. PCR, I told you, it is very sensitive, okay? And it can detect very small amount of organisms also. Very small amount of bacilli can be detected on this, right? So this is about your endometrial biopsy. So second comes your hysterosalpingogram. Now this is a very important. They can give you an image and ask you what are the typical features. What will you see? You will see that there is an irregular outline. A fluffy irregular outline is seen. Okay. And there is going to be a lot of lymphatic and vascular extravasation. Okay. There is a lot of extravasation of the contrast. Right. Then here you can see because of all these intrauterine adhesions, there are luminal filling defects. Okay, there are luminal filling defects which are present. So this is all, these are the findings that you are going to see in a hysterosalpingogram. Now mind you that active tuberculosis is a contraindication for HSG. Okay, it is a contraindication for HSG. But sometimes you might, the patient has not presented with some symptoms, you are not suspecting tuberculosis and you were evaluating for infertility and you sent for HSG. This is the kind of findings you are going to see. Now, this was about the uterine cavity. Now, let us look at the tubes. So, this is what? This is a tobacco pouch appearance. Okay, tobacco pouch appearance. What happens? Basically, your fimbria are agglutinated. Okay, so your ampulla and the proximal part will become filled with the contrast, and that is why it will look like a tobacco pouch. This is what? This is a golf club appearance. So what is happening here? See, you can see your entire tube has become so rigid. Okay, it has become rigid, and here the fimbria are agglutinated. So this looks like a golf club. Then here you can see small beaded appearance. So these are your beaded appearance of tubes. Then you can have corkscrew appearance. These tubes are coiled among on themselves. So there are various names and appearances that have been described in HSG for tuberculosis. So you should be familiar with some names like tobacco pouch and retort shaped golf club, beaded appearance. These are very important to remember. Other than that, you should be able to correlate with your clinical picture, your hysterosalpingogram findings, right? So hysterosalpingogram is done when? Generally day 9, day 10, we will be doing it. If you know that the patient is having active TB, then you are not supposed to do it because it will cause a flare up. Okay, fine. Then comes your... we discussed beaded appearance because of multiple constrictions, golf club. Then yes, there will be a lead pipe appearance. Why? Because the tube becomes very straight and rigid. Okay. And there will be jagged tubal contour. So irregular tubal contour is there. Sometimes calcification may be seen. HSG in tuberculosis is very, very important, guys. Then comes your ultrasound. Okay. So what will you see? Again, in the endometrium, what will you see? You will see a thin echogenic endometrium. You can see thin, you can see so many echogenicities, right? These bright spots. Thin, echogenic, irregular endometrium. This is a sign of damage to the endometrium. Here also you can see so much echogenicity is there, and the endometrium is disrupted in between. It is irregular. So irregular, thin, echogenic endometrium is going to tell you that yes, the endometrial lining is damaged. Okay. This is going to suggest about Asherman's syndrome. Okay. Then once we have looked at the uterus, let us look at the tubes and the adnexa. So in the tubes, you can see these incomplete septations might be present like this. Okay. And the tube is completely filled with fluid. So there can be a hydrosalpinx. Okay. If you cut open these tubes, no, you will see a lot of caseous, whitish caseous, cheesy material filling these tubes. Right, there can be formation of a TO mass. Fine. Then we go to hysteroscopy. So HSG, laparoscopy, hysteroscopy, there are very significant findings which are going to be suggestive of tuberculosis. This culture of tuberculosis, isolating the bacteria is not so easy because it is the growth of the bacteria is not so easy, and it is not present in large numbers. It is a Posse bacilli infection, right? But the findings on laparoscopy, hysteroscopy, and HSG are very, very suggestive of tuberculosis. So in hysteroscopy, what will you see? You will see that there is an absolutely pale endometrium. Okay, then you can see adhesions are present. Now these adhesions may be thin, they may be flimsy, they may be very thick and dense adhesions. Okay, see again here you can see the pale endometrium. Then you can see one caseating whitish deposit is present, right? And a shaggy outline. So this word is used, shaggy, to define the endometrial cavity, right? Then you go to laparoscopy. So in laparoscopy, if you do in a active tuberculosis case, what will you find? You will find that there is free fluid. Many times the peritoneum will also have these small miliary deposits might be present in the peritoneum. Okay. Then you can see this white color deposit. This arrow is there, no? This white color deposit. These are caseous deposits which are present, right? Then here you can see one huge hydrosalpinx has formed. So all these are basically findings suggestive of tuberculosis on laparoscopy. I'm showing you all these images because if they give you any such image, if they paint any such clinical picture for you, you should be able to answer this question. Now here, let us see completely this ovary has been engulfed. You can see this tube. Okay. It seems to be so coiled and beaded. Why is it beaded? Because here is one level of obstruction. Then here is one level of obstruction. So there are multiple obstructions which leads to the beaded appearance of the tube, and there is complete engulfment of the ovary by the tube. So there is, it's like a TO mass has formed. Okay. Then here what we are showing? Here we are showing that there are perihepatic adhesions. So your liver is pulled up to the anterior abdominal wall. What is this called? This is called as the Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome. Okay. This has been also asked in one of the previous papers. Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome. right? This can be seen in tuberculosis, it can also be seen in gonorrhea, chlamydia, wherever PID is happening and it is causing perihepatic adhesions, it is going to be caused Fitzhugh-Curtis syndrome. Okay, hi Parth. Okay, so now let us come to the management. So you have read a lot about this in medicine, but I am only going to tell you about the genital part of it. So we will follow the DOTS treatment, or we can give the non-DOTS treatment also. But if let us look at the DOTS treatment, then the patient is going to fall under category 1. Why? Because this is seriously ill extra pulmonary disease. Okay, category 1. So category 1 treatment is what? Two months of HRZE, that is your isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide and ethambutol, followed by 4 months of continuation phase, okay, of isoniazid and rifampicin. And this is given thrice weekly, right? This is direct observation treatment strategy. Suppose the patient is a relapse or a treatment failure, then the patient will go to category 2. Otherwise, a normal 28-year-old lady who has come with infertility, you did an endometrial biopsy and you found that it is showing caseating granulomas, she is going to be category 1. Now here you have a patient who has taken ATT before, but again she has interrupted the treatment and now come after 6 months. Then that is basically defaulter. Then you have treatment failure or relapse. It will all come under category 2. So category 2 is what? 2 months of HRZS. So you are adding streptomycin here. Then 1 month of HRZD and 5 months of HRD. Okay. So the total treatment duration is 8 months here. Here you have a duration of 6 months. Then you can also give non-DOTS treatment is also given. So that you will give daily treatment. Okay. Fine. So this is about the management of genitourinary tuberculosis. Now we can manage tuberculosis with your drugs. Okay, but what about the outcomes? See, TB will be cured. Yes, TB is going to be cured. But the tubes are already damaged. You cannot restore those tubes. Okay, even tuberoplasty does not have very good results in tuberculosis. Okay, then suppose if the problem is infertility, then yes, you can bypass these tubes by using in vitro fertilization. But again, if she is having hydrosalpinx, then what do you need to do? You need to go and clip these tubes, because otherwise that fluid that is present in the hydrosalpinx is going to come and damage the embryo. But okay, now suppose we are done with the part of the tubes. Now what about the endometrial cavity? Even the endometrial lining is not very good, and that is why even after your ATT, even after giving your antitubercular therapy, and then going for your ART procedures, whether be it IVF or IUI, any of these procedures, the outcomes still remain poor. Okay, the outcomes still remain poor because the endometrial lining is also damaged. No matter how much ATT you give or how much adhesiolysis you do, the outcomes as compared to the general other causes of infertility are much poorer. Okay, right? Then what about role of surgery? Is there role of surgery? One thing is, you should really avoid surgery in a tuberculosis patient. Suppose you have done a surgery, if you were doing a diagnostic laparoscopy for an infertile patient and you found findings that there was fluid, there were multiple miliary deposits on the peritoneum, okay, and sometimes you saw some caseous deposits, perihepatic adhesions, what should you do? You should just take a sample of the fluid and just take a biopsy from these caseous deposits. That's all. Do nothing else, come out, start the patient on anti-tubercular therapy. Okay, start the patient on ATT. Now, so another scenario is where you have started the patient on ATT, but she is having really huge TO abscess, or she is having a big hydrosalpinx and pyosalpinx, then what to do? Then in those patients, yes, you can start the ATT after 3 weeks or after 2 months of ATT. If still it is not resolving, you can go in for a surgery, but again, you should only be doing a limited surgery, just drainage of the abscess, that's all. Okay, you do not want to do adhesiolysis, you do not want to remove all the bowel that has come and stuck on it, all that, we don't want to do all that. Okay, so and then again we will complete the course of DOTS therapy, right? Why are we not doing all this? Because there is a very high chance of complications in tuberculosis abdomen. There is whenever you will start dissecting, you will not find any planes, there is going to be a lot of bleeding, and wherever there is going to be an injury, there is going to be formation of fistula. This is the very important problem in tuberculosis. That is why we avoid doing any heroic surgery in tuberculosis, right? So very limited surgery, and that too, once you have started ATT, after that you do your surgery and then again complete the ATT, right guys? So I hope, I think this was the end of it. Yeah, so tomorrow I will discuss in the special class, same time 7:30. It is a free special class, and we will discuss about STDs. and it will be MCQ based. Okay, we'll do one two MCQs, then we'll discuss about that. So we'll discuss about syphilis, herpes, chancroid, all these disorders. We are going to discuss tomorrow 7:30. It is a 1 hour class. Okay, it will be MCQ based, and that will bring an end to all this this entire unit of infections, of genital infections. So I hope today's topic was clear to you. And TB in India is a very, very important topic. We cannot go wrong with tuberculosis. So tomorrow we will discuss about all the major STDs, and 7:30 special class, free class, right? And then on Saturday we will do more MCQs about your genital infections and other things, fine? So thank you very much. If you have any doubts, I'll be very happy to clear them. Please, otherwise, please like us, subscribe us, follow us on YouTube, Telegram, use my code Dr. Deepika. For tomorrow also, for the special class, for those who are logging in the first time, use my code Dr. Deepika to log in for the app for the special class. The timing is the same, 7:30. Okay. So if any doubts, please write in the chat box. I'll be very happy to answer. Hi Sneha, thank you. And hi Uttam, I hope you like the class after a long time. If no doubts, then I'll close the session for you today. Thank you very much, guys. Okay, tomorrow 7:30, I'll see you in the special class. We'll discuss STDs.